Blessed be the one holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
Let us pray. Holy wisdom, in your loving kindness you created and restored us when we were lost. Inspire us with your truth that we may love you with our whole minds and run to you with open hearts. Through Christ our Savior. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen to those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
For the love of the one who has heard my cry. I will walk in the presence of God. In the cords of my death I was tangled round. I will walk in the presence of God. Those who seek you in anguish shall not be bound. I will walk in the presence of God. I will walk in the presence of God. In the land of the living. For the love of the one who has heard my cry, I will walk in the presence of God. God is mercy and grace, and the simple are blessed. I will walk in the presence of God. Raised me up in my pain, got my safety and rest. I will walk in the presence of God. I will walk in the presence of God. In the land of the living. For the love of the one who has heard my cry, I will walk in the presence of God. God has raised up my soul from the gates of death. I will walk in the presence of God. God has dried all my tears and renewed my breath. I will walk in the presence of God. I will walk in the presence of God. In the land of the living. For the love of the one who has heard my cry, I will walk in the presence of God. What return can I give for the gifts I claim? I will walk in the presence of God. Lift the cup of salvation and praise your name. I will walk in the presence of God. I will walk in the presence of God. In the land of the living. For the love of the one who has heard my cry, I will walk in the presence of God.
A reading from the book of James. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they are guided by a very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire. And the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of nature, and is itself set on fire by hell. Every species of beast and bird, reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth comes blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives, or a grapevine figs? No more can salt water yield fresh. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thank you, God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
This passage is found in the middle of the Gospel of Mark, connecting two halves of the life of Jesus, according to Mark. In the first half of the Gospel, there are stories about Jesus healing and teaching. The final half is the headlong journey to Jerusalem, to the Passion, to the empty tomb. This middle section is placed between two accounts of blindness, of Jesus healing the blind, which scholars believe is a comment on the blindness of the disciples. But what is it that they couldn't see? Jesus and the disciples are near Caesarea Philippi, the center of the worship of the emperor and the Greek god. The Galileans were in the shadow of the power of Rome when Jesus asked the disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" Probably they rushed to answer the question like eager students. "John the Baptist, Elijah, one of the prophets." They might also have said, "A healer, a teacher, someone who casts out demons." Then Jesus asked them, "Who do you say that I am? Who am I to you?" I wonder if there was a long pause after the second question. Gee, how do we put it? Is this the right answer? Maybe somebody else will answer for me. I wonder if there was a pause where they looked down at their feet or to the side, avoiding his gaze. Then Peter blurted out, "You are the Messiah." And instead of praising him for his faith, Jesus told him sharply not to use that word in anyone else's hearing. When he called Jesus the Messiah, Peter was naming him as the anointed king who would liberate Israel and reign on the throne of David. The Messiah wielded royal power, but Jesus proceeded to tell him and the other disciples that he was not that kind of Messiah. Later, he showed them that he wasn't that kind of Messiah when he entered Jerusalem, not in a chariot, but on the back of a colt. Then Jesus called the villagers to come and listen with the disciples, and he described what it would demand of them to be his followers. He warned them that the stakes were high and that they had to make a decision. He told them of the possibility of persecution, the likelihood of persecution. Save, lose, save. He told them that self-preservation could not be their highest value if they were to be his followers. And Jesus chastised Peter for protesting the suffering and death that Jesus saw in his own future. According to the understanding of Peter, Messiah necessarily meant royal triumph and the restoration of Israel's honor, the ousting of Rome. Against this, Jesus argued that the Son of Man necessarily meant suffering. This was so because an advocate of true justice for the poor, the sick, the vulnerable, he was the human one who necessarily came into conflict with the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and ultimately with Rome. In other words, Jesus was not talking about some abstract fate, but of the political inevitability of going up against the powers that be. Jesus taught his followers and showed them in everything he did that the only way to truly live is to give yourself away for the sake of others. Jesus advised them in the starkest terms that to follow him meant they had to be prepared to give without counting the cost. It took courage. And then we reach those dreaded words, take up your cross. In Jesus' time, the cross was an overwhelmingly political and military form of punishment by Rome. It was state terrorism, used almost exclusively on rebels, revolutionaries, escaped slaves, and violent criminals. Whatever else we might think of Jesus, Rome saw in his behavior a clear political threat. And never forget, he called upon his followers to join him in doing what it took to acquire their own cross. The whole conversation began near Caesarea Philippi, yes, but the text gives one more detail about where these conversations took place. It's a little phrase we should always listen for when we hear Jesus doing something. On the way. Hodos. For those of you who are always listening for a new Greek word, here you go. Hodos, way. Hodos can simply refer to a road or a path, or it can refer to a way of life. It became a title of early Christians. The first followers of Jesus were called the people of the way. In the book of Acts and in many other places, being on the way is a theme throughout the Gospel of Mark, especially in this section. Jesus is on the way when he asks this question of the disciples, as though literally striding down a path and quizzing his followers as they walk. The phrase again appears a chapter later when the disciples were arguing about who was the greatest among the disciples, proving that they were blind to the way of Jesus. Jesus was on his way again when the rich young man asked his question about what he must do to obtain eternal life. And Jesus replied that he had to give away what he had. Perhaps the most significant use of hodos is in the narrative about blind Bartimaeus that comes at the end of this section, who was found on the side of the way, and then after the healing miracle, when Jesus opened his eyes, Bartimaeus was able to follow Jesus on the way. The blindness of the disciples was their lack of understanding that the way of Jesus was the way of compassion, not of power. There would be no crown or castle, no earthly greatness. Jesus didn't teach his disciples a litany of rules. He taught them to be prayerful and giving. He showed them that the glory of God was in healing God's suffering people. He led them on the way, en te hodo. He taught them to walk in his own dusty footsteps. Most of the life of discipleship is to be lived out in practice, on the way. If we have the courage to follow him, then we will find that it's a path of self-giving and a way to freedom and true joy. It is the way we will truly gain our lives. It is the way we will gain eternal life. Amen. Let us stand as you are able and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Loving God, with you, every transition and new start is a reminder of your goodness. Your creation is ever-changing, and we are part of the fresh, amazing newness in our world. After all based in the past year, we come to this year changed, with new levels of gratitude, hope, and connection written in us. With thanks and love, we ask for your blessing. For the church throughout the world, that we all may be one in witness and proclamation of the gospel, let us pray. Loving God, for the peace and stability of all peoples and for the leaders of the nations, that there may be justice and peace, let us pray. Loving God, we pray for students of all ages, abilities, and backgrounds. We pray for their hearts and all they hold, excitement and nervousness, disappointment and hope. We give you all our loves and fears. For the courage and resilience to meet the year ahead, let us pray. Loving God,
hear our prayers.
We pray for parents, Wrap them in your reassuring love. When questions remain unanswered and the realm of control is finite, bless them with peace and the promise you are there with their child of any age as they enter school. For those who care for children, let us pray. Loving God, we pray for teachers, staff, and administrators. Bless these faithful servants with courage and confidence. Give them peace, patience, and the bravery to justly serve all your children. For their delight in their students and the recognition of the ways children are also our teachers, let us pray. Loving God, we pray for health and wholeness, fun and growth, surprise and amazement for this year ahead, knowing you will hold us in your love all the way through. The joy of learning throughout our lives, let us pray. Loving God, for a blessing on our homes, for our family and friends, and all whom we love, let us pray. Loving God, for the sick and suffering, especially Lori and Greg, Tracy S., Jill Taylor, Mary Farrington, Patricia Adams, Bianca Trednick, and all who care for their needs, let us pray. Loving God, for those who have died, especially Jan Gassaway, Irene Mills, Brett Harrison, Dave Lau, Alice Lorick, and John Adams. And for those who mourn, let us pray. Loving God, let us commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God.
Loving God, bless the year before us with your mercy and strength. Bless us with vision to see the miracle of your presence in every sacred, ordinary moment. During this time of pandemic, as we seek to learn from all who become our teachers, may the changes in our world and in ourselves bring growth of goodness and grace. May each day shine with the light of your love and help us live with grateful hearts and sharing hands. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you. Please be seated. Well, it is a wonderful blessing to see all of you, to have this beautiful day to share, to see faces I haven't seen in some time. And I'm glad you are joining us, and I am glad that we are able to reach out to those online. We are not able to include YouTube in this service because we are back to one phone as our broadcast platform. But hey, it works. And thank you, Thomas. I appreciate your help with this. It's wonderful to have our musicians back. It's wonderful to be able to sing. And we restrained ourselves from the exuberant picnic we normally have because of obvious reasons. But I look forward in the future to being able to share lots of fried chicken with all of you. if you like chicken. Anyway, so there are a few things to let you know. We are beginning our program year. And it looks, once again, different from the way we anticipated and the way we wanted it to. But I want to alert you to the fact that if you are thinking of being part of the children's choir, or if perhaps a member of your family is thinking of being a part of the children's choir, those rehearsals are starting this week. Hooray. They will be on Zoom, and the clergy will join as we can, joyfully. And so I hope that that will kick off the music year for all of our children. We are in the process of figuring out workload at the office because our beloved Jessica Carpenter was called to do other work with some other clients, and so she's not working for us part-time anymore, which means that we have more work and fewer hands in the office. If you are interested in volunteering, please speak to Katie Arp. But in the meanwhile, we are going to be shifting, not this week, but the following week, we are going to be shifting our Wednesday email to the Thursday email, which will allow us to get the bulletin into that email. We're trying to avoid spamming you, and we're also trying to get everything done. We're going to wait so that this week you'll be able to get the Zoom link for the Wednesday healing service, which will also be virtual, and you'll be able to pick that up this Wednesday. It will be the same link. If you haven't availed yourself of that wonderful service where a great deal of community is built and a very prayerful atmosphere pervades, I would invite you to consider doing it. And you can check in, just click on the link, and nobody will do anything scary. It will just be inviting you in. We are beginning adult confirmation classes, and so if you are considering confirmation, reaffirmation, reception, or baptism, please contact Father Andy or Amy Gerber. We are doing this, that's him. And Amy's somewhere over here. Yeah, there's Amy. One of those two people. It is preparation for the first visitation of Bishop Akiyama. She will be coming to St. Paul's on November 21st, Christ the King. And yes, we can do a happy dance. Yes, we can. It's gonna be great. And if you've been considering one of those things, or if you wanna find out what one of those things is, ask somebody, because it will be a great and joyful day. I'd like to say a word about communion. We are going to have two standing stations, and you will come forward to receive the bread only. The standing stations will be roughly where these two speakers are, and the side that I'm on will also have gluten-free wafers. So if that is your need, come forward for that. And if you would like to receive a blessing but not consume the bread, then come forward and cross your arms over your chest and you will receive a blessing. All are welcome regardless of age, affiliation, religious tradition. This is the Lord's table, and we invite you to find strength and sustenance here. Many of you know that very often at the Mass on the Grass service, a great deal about art. And I'd like to just say a word about the image on the bulletin cover. That is St. Michael. St. Michael is bearing a sword to bat away and beat down evil. And that statue is a replacement for the original statue, which has been on the top of the Castel Sant'Angelo, which is part of the papal buildings in Rome. And the reason it's there is that there was a plague that was destroying Rome, and the Pope was in procession, and he looked up and he saw the Archangel Michael with a sword above Castel Sant'Angelo, and he took that to be a sign that the plague was going to end, and it did. And so that is what I am offering you as a sign that what we are going through is going to end, and we will be together and we will be strong. I've been thinking a great deal about St. Michael the Archangel, and I offer that consideration to you. There are forces of goodness and strength in this world that will carry us through, and we can also be that to each other. Speaking of perseverance and strength, the children among us and many others who are not children are going to be resuming studies now in a very different environment. And I would like to offer a blessing for them and also a blessing on the school supplies and gifts that have been brought to support families that have not had stable homes, housing, and resources. I would like to invite all who are students to please stand as you, where you are. I'm not going to make everybody come forward. Come on, stand up. Let's go. I know you're there. I have a blessing for you. May God bless you who are students with curiosity and imagination and the patience to persevere. May God help you to love your neighbors and to love yourself and to see Christ in all those you meet. May God grant you wisdom, peace, and fruitful growth. May you have agile minds and questing hearts, and may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you this year and always. Amen. Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life, you formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us. And so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then, in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word made mortal flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that with all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence, as our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah, we break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We are in the one body, we all share in one bread. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Light descendeth,
from the realms of endless day. Let the hearts of men be as the darkness cleaves at his feet the six-winged seraph, cherubim with sleepless eye, veil their faces to the presence, as with ceaseless voice they cry, Alleluia, 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 Lord Most High.
Please stand as you are able. Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and the house of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make the journey with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind. And the blessing of God, who made us, who loves us, and who travels with us, be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
Who wanders
go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thank you.